I like energy as a topic. That's kind of my work and my hobby. But I think the way we use energy, the way we produce energy, needs to change. Who agrees with that? Fine, I can actually finish. Job's done. So that's easy. But we're really in a pressure cooker to do that. There is little time. It's a big job. And many people will think, oh dear, we may have to do that. There's all kind of reasons they have to do it, but it's going to be costly, it's going to be difficult, and we may not be as wealthy, or we don't even have all these great energy services in the future. Well, let's take a look at that. The graphic I want to show, I'm not going to be friendly on you with the graphics, but the graphic behind me is core output of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change. That comes from these thick reports of thousands of pages with thousands of scientists involved summarizing these hundreds and hundreds of papers on energy systems and climate change and effects of climate change. And it's about the most compact summary there is of these reports, because on the left-hand side you see emission scenarios that go up with gigatons of carbon that we emit per year using coal, oil and gas, etc. And the gray part is business as usual. We've been great in doing business as usual for decades. Already early 90s, we concluded there's something wrong with this and the climate is affected. And ever since, we have been doing business as usual. More economic growth, more people, more coal, more oil, more gas, more CO2 emissions. And with the best knowledge that we have today, let's see if that works, those emissions will correspond during the century to that temperature effect on our global climate. A possible change, oh dear, I should not do that. A possible change, hey, that's weird. Yeah, a possible change of the global mean temperature between maybe 4, but it could be 8 degrees. It could be 8 degrees. Average estimate, maybe 6. And there's little scientific debate about what that means. That's sheer disaster. That is meters of sea level rise. That is massive damage to biodiversity. That is massive loss of food production capacity, mass migration, all the misery you for sure know because you're a well-educated audience. So there's good reasons why we agreed, also in Paris, to settle on 2, maybe 1.5 degrees. So we will not stop climate change, there will be climate change, but we can kind of try to keep it under control. That's good. And that, in the meantime, corresponds, that's bad, that corresponds to the green area right over there. That's the emission pathway that we have to look at to meet that target. And that's not only a dramatic shift in the trend, it's just the reverse to business as usual. But it's even, if you take a close look, an area in that green band that's below zero, negative emissions. So today, given the emissions we have already created and what we need to do to meet 1.5-2 degree target, we need options to remove CO2 from the atmosphere. For example, planting more forests, and maybe converting that biomass in plants that capture CO2 and store it on the ground again. Negative emissions. That was a solid conclusion of the IPCC work. It's that desperate, and we have only a number of decades to do the job. That is not good news. You thought you were going to have a fun evening, right? Well, that is good news. I already hit the button. This is good news. This was remarkable. We had the Paris Agreement. The whole world agreed the problem is real. We should try to stop it. We should settle on the 1.5 degree, and every country needs to come with plans to reduce those emissions over time. And many responded. You can have criticism on that. Is that all fixed? I don't know. No, it's not all fixed. But it was an amazing achievement that he had that agreement. And it basically said, the problem is there, we cannot deny it. Well, there are some yellow and white-haired politicians that tend to deny it and may come back to those guys, but you can say the world agrees to act. So that's the good news. So you can be a little bit happier again. So another graphic with maybe a tough figure. Can we do that? Yes, and this is one of hundreds of graphics that all look a little bit the same, have the same message, that could do the job. But you see here on the y-axis is exajoules, 10 to the 18th joules, and that's the amount of energy that we use today. Today is about 550 of those exajoules. Again, the sum of coal, oil, gas, that's the bulk, about 80-85%. Some hydro, some nuclear, a little bit of renewables. The green part's bioenergy. And if we let that go, uncontrolled, business as usual, it may quadruple in this century. Quadruple. And you may have seen the Rijnmond area, you may have seen the brown coal mines in Germany, or we know the gas fields here in Slochteren and all the infrastructure worldwide. Times four, right? That's huge, that footprint of that, the investment, the capital, it's incredible to meet that energy demand alone. Can we then keep that within our carbon budget, even with negative emissions? Well, this picture displays that it is, first of all, a matter of everything we know we have to combine. And the gray area is really a bit misleading, energy efficiency. And that sounds very simple, and in this graphic it's way too simple. But it means controlling growth in energy use by new factories. We need new industries that are twice as efficient as today, use renewable energy, capture CO2. It means transport that does the same job as today with one-third of the energy we use for displacing a ton or a person. It means a built environment that's energy neutral, produces just as much energy as it uses. That's the energy efficiency option. So it means a completely different infrastructure or design of cities, different industrial areas, circular economy, etc. That's one of the wedges. And that there's solar, there's wind, there's still some fossil fuels in the middle that we may be able to use in a limited carbon budget if we capture the CO2 that is released when using it. So that's an option we need too. Nuclear, that's not really emphasized, other scenarios show that. And there is bio-based economy, so growing crops in a sustainable way, converting it to fuels, to feedstocks, and maybe also with CCS. Again, it's a massive job, but it is imaginable that we do that. Now, this was kind of unfriendly for many people, especially for those yellow and white-haired politicians, because then you have to explain gigatons of carbon and global temperature change and exajoules, so it's difficult. But there's one language that many of these white and yellow-haired politicians understand, that's money. And this graphic, it's very full, is about money. And that translates the required changes in our global energy system, all the infrastructure, from coal plants to solar and to from the current cars to a new generation of cars, etc., to financial impact. And that's very meaningful because the scale that you see here on the y-axis is hundreds of billions of dollars per year, per part of the energy sector, for decades. Hundreds of billions of dollars per year going into new electricity systems, renewable energy, carbon capture and storage infrastructure, maybe a new generation of nuclear, and for sure, also on the right-hand side, energy efficiency measures, which can mean a lot of things, as I already briefly mentioned. Add everything up that is above the x-axis, and you're talking about trillions of dollars, on and on and on. If your business is above the x-axis, so to say, you're in business. That's jobs. That's new products. That's new services. So that's fantastic, and that's good news. There's a major opportunity in that part, in regions that develop those industries and infrastructures and are leading that. But below the x-axis, there's something going down, of course, because we will need less coal, less gas, less oil, less refineries, and those are the guys on the losing end. That's also the vested interest. That's also where the yellow and white-haired politicians are sometimes. So we have a major economic shift here. There's a major opportunity, but there's also something we really need to govern, and that is where do we lose the jobs and the investment and the power also in the system. Add it all up, plus minus, that is definitely a beneficial effect for economic development, new industries, etc. So that's an outcome of this type of work. And it leads to this summary. And fantastic is that key institutions in the field have repeated this all over and over again. And I really call it the biggest no-brainer in the energy field. Because, yeah, we know what we need to do. It's going to be massive. It's going to be cost a lot of money. If it's costly, I will come back to that. So that's true. But there's a key point. If we do that with a vengeance and we put pressure on all these new options like solar and wind and new cars and fuel cells and LED lighting, etc., they will get cheaper. And I will come back to that after that. So that's one effect if we do that. The other effect, of course, is classic economics. Use less and less oil and gas and coal, but will get cheaper too. So some people say that's bad news because then your new options don't compete as much. But if you do that altogether, it means on the medium to long term, there's an upfront cost, but the total energy supply in the future will be cheaper than doing nothing. I call that the biggest no-brainer in the energy field because this is economically perfectly sensible to do. But it doesn't come for free. And this is still part of the good news show because the curves you see here, there's a lot of details, don't focus on the details, they're called learning curves. And they show historically how the cost of all these key technologies, PV, wind power, fuel cells, LED lighting also, and many other examples, have gone down because of their increased development, increased deployment. And there seem to be rules of steel there, which is really remarkable. Every doubling of the market, every doubling of production of these technologies generally leads to a 20, 25, sometimes 30% cost reduction. So you produce more and the costs go down. So that is something we observed in the past. And the PV cells are fantastic because today we can build solar parks in Chile, in the Middle East, in Australia, that deliver electricity already below 3 cents, euro cents per kilowatt hour, while fossil costs may be 5 or 6 cents. And we have seen the same already in wind energy, already today on the North Sea. The first park is now planned that will be built without subsidy. Cost parity has been achieved. So this is a massive achievement that those learning curves go down, and they're all over the place. Not only for these renewable energy technologies, but also for fridges. LED lights, already mentioned, for gas turbines, new industrial processes, etc. So they are there, and that's fantastic. But it doesn't come for free, because if you go into these cases, what made those costs go down? And that's a lot of things combined, and it differs per option. So you need more, and sometimes they have to go bigger, there's the economy of scale. But for sure, there is a lot of research and development there. So that's the scientific arena. Inventions, new materials, better designs. That is a part of that engine that drives these costs down. And it's also clever business. It's how do you plan that? Are you quicker and quicker in installing that? Better services. So that entire process of technological learning is actually very complex. It's an innovation system that has to work together. And the better you do that, the more rapid the cost goes down. And this is some wording around wind energy that has been a big success, for example, by Denmark, etc. And we can see the real results now on the North Sea today, but we need that in many more options. So this is what we're really looking at to make that entire energy transition affordable up to profitable, because we're always talking about, yeah, we need new stuff. And I hardly dare to touch that button anymore before. Yeah. So we need new stuff, and that's more expensive than a fossil reference. So that's kind of the theoretical way to look at it. Of course, it's a fuzzy line usually in reality. And the cost will go down. At the moment, you keep investing it, but it will cost more. So this may be taxes or subsidies or whatever helps. But this point is what you want. Break-even point, cost parity. And at the moment you're there, you're in business, because then you have the cheaper alternative. What we see today with solar plants in the right positions already. So that's what we want. But it's not easy, because we have many of the technologies we still need. New biorefineries, CCS systems, etc. These advanced new factories with energy efficient technologies that need to come over these mountain of death, as it's almost called. And many of these technologies get stuck ramping up. So it's also rise and fall, but a little bit different here. So usually first costs rise, and then they can go down. But the timeline here is usually decades. So this doesn't come for free. So the big message of the talk is there is no silver bullet, no magic solution that will solve the problem of climate change and change the energy system, because it's many things that have to work together. And all these things also need development and investment. So fashions in energy saying, maybe I don't like nuclear energy, or maybe I don't like biofuels, which is another thing, or I don't like carbon capture and storage, are not wise. It is about consistent work to develop these options and bring them to the market. So fashions and rise and fall of options that we have seen a lot in the energy field is not what we should do. We should keep working on them consistently to make that energy transition happen in a very profitable and affordable way. So it's not a magic solution. It's all combined and hard work. Now, is that a sobering message or not? That was it.